staring into your eyes makes my heart come alive. Suddenly brought to life when I met you. Reaching beyond the skies, running deep, stretching wide. Perfect love realized here with you. Now this love is for real, you will never let go, never let go. Oh, and it's more than just words, love beyond my control, out of control.
Jesus. All right. Well, first of all, if you're here for the first time, we're not that this crazy. We're crazier some other times. And this is just a special day. And over the weekend, Friday through Saturday, this place was turned into an Encounter with God retreat. There were people here, 25 or so, and their staff. I'd like to recognize the pastors, the facilitators, the people that cooked, stand guard, and everyone that participated to make the retreat a success. Can we give God glory for them, please? Amen. There's another one coming up, Lord willing, in September. Please join, and you would see the difference. And this afternoon, tonight at 5 o'clock, come back and hear their testimonies of how God broke the chains that was upon them, and you would be surprised. You would notice some of them, the burning of, there's this burnt offering. Did you see that? There were people that actually wrote down the curses and all the articles of affection. They burned them, and they're saying that they are released from the past, and they are opening a new door for God to work in their lives. These are some of them. Can you stand, all those EGR attendees? Some of them. These are some of them representing. Turn around, please. Let them see your faces. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. And all those staff, can they all stand? The one pastors and those that I have facilitated, God bless you. The cooks, where are they? And all the rest of their pastor, Noel, And they really did a fantastic job. And so don't let them, no, they're not crazy. They're just in love. You know, they just felt so close to the Lord. And we invite you next time, all right? Well, today is Communion Sunday and also a Mission Sunday. Every first Sunday of the month, we have communion. At the same time, we have the mission giving. As a matter of fact, let me just give you an update. ALC Philippines, one of them, Caloocan Church, they had about 56 water baptism last month. 56 water baptism. And we had, we will recognize them later on, those that 22 were water baptized last Sunday, and we'll recognize them before the end of celebration. Well, again, as you prepare, we will give our regular tithes and offering in a few moments, and please prepare them, and after that, we'll go to the next, to the celebration. We will take now the regular tithes and offering unto the Lord. Let's pray. Father, again, we thank you so much as we celebrate your goodness. We are stewards of your resource. We want to bless you. We want to be faithful in tithes to you because you deserve it. We give you all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. It's our tradition. Please let us stand and just come up to the lattes. Give them your offering. At the same time, if you have any prayer requests, we want everyone. If you have any prayer needs, just come and say, God, I need your direction. Come, please. Nobody, please, we invite everyone. Everyone to come and just participate and give.
When I'm with you, just can't stop getting closer to you. And conform to the image of you. There's a peace running deep from my soul. My spirit bear witness that I'm a child of a king. And I'm sorry, I just can't walk the way I used to. I used to do, I just can't do them no more. There's a peace running deep from my soul.
Amen. May I invite everyone please to stand, and if you have your words with you, just hold on to your word, and we will pray for now. Father, again, we thank you so much the privilege to be part of your kingdom, and we are so blessed to be adopted as sons and daughters of the King. Thank you so much, O God, for your people that continues to be faithful in their stewardship. The tithes belong to you, and so we ask you that you will open up the windows for heaven, pour out your blessings upon them, but they won't have any rooms to contain. We give you all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Everyone will say, Amen. 1 Corinthians, please remain standing and turn to the word. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And this is where we're going to read a word. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. And it is our communion Sunday. And so it is just worthy for us to read the word. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. And says, this is the writer's saying, Paul says, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was to be betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you, do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drink the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, And so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment for himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many are already asleep or RIP. Father, we thank you this morning. And Lord, I ask you that you would embrace each one of us. Sometimes become like it's part of our tradition, but this morning, oh God, I pray that you will reveal to us your greatness through your word as we partake of the Lord's Supper. We thank you in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone will say amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for standing. You may be seated. Thank you so much for coming this morning. I'd like to talk about understanding the Lord's Supper. Understanding the Lord's Supper. And what I'd like to propose is that we will try to connect the Old Covenant and the New Covenant with the Lord's Supper. Where is this in a short manner? Why are we participating in this kind of ritual for others? Is it something that we just do because we have grown to in a situation? Every first Sunday of the month, we break bread. Not only we break bread, we have worship and fellowship, and we have stewardship, and then we partake of the communion. Why? Why do we take communion or the Lord's Supper? Is it because it has become a tradition? Has it become part of our ritual? For some, it has become a tradition indeed. They don't know why they're doing it because they've seen others or their parents do it. So therefore, they take the Lord's Supper as if, well, I've known nothing but to do it. Traditions are fine, but there are traditions that are very dangerous. Some of the good traditions, I grew up in the Philippines, and so there are traditions in the Philippines that are very unique, maybe, I don't know, but maybe in other Asian countries, or even in Guam, maybe. My grandma, when she visits us, and we've learned this, we would have breakfast in the morning. And breakfast in the morning typically is egg and all that, and then you have this pandesal, or you go bread. You know those bread, pandesal. They're very kind of, definitely kind of tough. So we would notice our grandma, she would dip the bread, pandesal, in the coffee, and she would chew on it. I said, wow. So we would do that. And others would do it. My mom would do it. And we would do it. And we never thought, why? Because they said, well, it's because it tastes good. And we would do it. As a matter of fact, one of the countries, if you don't mind, without coffee, I know here in Guam or in other countries, you don't give your children coffee, right? You don't, because it's like, whoa, you don't want them to be climbing up the walls. But in the Philippines, it's part of it. That's why you can see those kids, they're all hyped up. And we don't know why, because of the coffee. And so we said, Mom, I said, we would ask her, Mom, why is Grandma dipping the... And I said, well, because it's in the bakery, it's dirty. It's dirty, so they have to dip it so that's clean. It never... That's not true. We found out later on, because our grandmas usually, they don't have any teeth. They don't have any teeth, and so they cannot chew with their gum. And so they dip the bread in coffee, all right? And that's not all. Once they dip the coffee, once they dip the bread in the coffee, they don't throw the coffee. They drink it, and have to cleanse it. And that is a tradition. In an old church, there was this, in the western part of the United States, there was this church. You can tell it's a renovated church. And every time that people would walk in, they would go on the side of a wall and actually kneel down. You know, they will kneel down. And they said, why are they doing it? And so they said, they would ask, people would come in. Now they have the sanctuary, but on the side of the wall, they would kneel down and pray. And nobody knew about it. Why are they doing like a wall? Why would they kneel down just because of that? And so finally, a person just said, you know, I need to find out why is that wall important? And so he found out, he started going through the elders, the pastors, And everyone, why are people, especially the older ones, they kneel down on that wall as if it's like a magic wall. So finally, one of the oldest, he finally found one of the oldest members of the church that is in a senior citizen home. And says, Grandma says, why do people in your church, why do they actually kneel down on that wall and there's nothing there? And she started laughing. Ay naku, she said. She's from Chamorro. Ay naku. And says, what happened is that when the church was small, all right, when the church was small, that was the sanctuary on the side. That's a building. It's just like a small building. And so that is the sanctuary where the cross and so their tradition is to kneel down, and then they will sit down. Evidently, what had happened is that they got money and they renovated the church, all right? They added an additional wing, all right? But they left that because it is very important for the history of the church. And eventually, that particular part, people started, you know what? We have a sanctuary there. Why would we still have this? And so they started painting the wall. They painted the wall, and it became part. But the traditionally other people that grew up with that church, all right, they still continue to do it because they feel they're holy. And the rest of the people that started doing it because they thought it was the traditional for the church to kneel down before that wall before they entered, not realizing it is because people think that is where that used to be the sanctuary. So there are many things. For example, now this morning I would venture to say, why have you taken communion before? Why do we take communion? Have you thought about that? Well, if you are one of them, I have got good news for you. Don't worry. There are many people that are taking communion without knowing the value. And so therefore, it has become for them to continue to take communion as if for them, if they don't take communion, it doesn't cleanse them. But there's something significant, and it is my prayer before we partake of this communion that you will begin to say that you are doing it. This tradition, godly tradition, was given from the Lord Jesus Christ himself to his disciples, to the church, and the church that includes all of us. Why do we partake of the Lord's Supper? When we talk about the Lord's Supper, we talk about a covenant. A covenant is a contract or a trust initiated by two people for common benefit. A covenant simply means to cover. You will always see these terms: covenant, New Testament, covering, New Covenant, Old Covenant. Covenant simply means a contract initiated by both parties for mutual benefit. But this contract is different. See, in a regular contract you would sign, you would see it. Is it beneficial for me? Is it beneficial for the others? They always try to find what will be advantageous to them. What I present to you this morning, the covenant, the testament, the contract that God has initiated for our behalf, it is for our benefit. Once you understand this, you would say, God, how good and how great you are. Covenant is a pledge, a guaranteed agreement between parties that is based on trust. That's based on trust. And a covenant, for it to have power, it has to be obligatory. Obligatory meaning it has to be something that you have to do. There's a lot, that's what it called for the lawyers, there's what it called the last will and testament, right? What do you do that? You enforce your will when you pass on to the others regarding your properties or your decision. Last will and testament is very enforceable. That is a covenant. Now, God himself made covenant. Number one, He made a covenant with Adam. Remember when Adam and Eve fell? In Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, it says, I will make a covenant with you. There will be enmity between you and the devil, but I will protect you. I will even protect you in your lineage. The second covenant is a covenant of protection for Noah. Remember that? In Genesis chapter 8 and 9, God made a covenant with Noah that he will protect him. A covenant initiated by a loving God for the protection of his Noah and his family. And the third one, God made a covenant with Abraham to be the father of chosen nation and for all of us. A covenant in Genesis 15 that he will begin to protect his lineage. Not only that, God initiated the covenant with Abraham. He continued again to Moses. And Moses was given, because of his promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, it continues on for 4,000 years before the coming of Jesus Christ. A covenant was made by our God to a sinful nation. Amazing. There are several things that I want you to take note. Number one is this, on the old covenant. The covenant, the terms or the covenant, the old covenant, or the old agreement were confirmed with a sacrifice. The terms of the old covenant were confirmed by a sacrifice. A sacrifice, either a lamb or an animal, has to be sacrificed. Noah, when everything, the flood subsided, he said that he built an altar and offered a burnt offering. Think about that for a moment. Animals were there, and what do? Do you kill an animal? Of course, when you kill that animal, there's no more to continue that. But God demands the blood must be spilled to seal that covenant. Everything that we do for the Lord involves sacrifice. Everything that God has involves sacrifice. God is picturing before us the beauty of God's greatness, that he's saying, I am the one doing. It has to be confirmed. When we talk about covenant as well, to make a covenant, there has to be a cut. It is a cut. In the military or terms, you cut an order. Cut. Prepare. For the Jews, they know it. Cut meaning has to be totally death. For the animal, covenant must be, amen. God, in his goodness, the fall of man, do not look away from sin. That has to be paid by someone, something. Can you imagine, in the old covenant, you have to sacrifice. What you're simply saying is this. Number two, there's a sacrifice. Number two, the sacrifice under the old covenant were temporary. The sacrifice in the old covenant are temporary, meaning it's not sufficient, has to be done over and over and over again to appease the penalty of sin. But sin is there, it just covered. And some of us have gone to from other religion wherein you have to continue to a ritual of cleansing, that you become a burden because there is not sufficiency. And God planned it that way, that the payment for the old covenant sin is not enough. Romans 3:20 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's an emptiness in our hearts that nothing can ever, ever appease, because sin must be dealt with, for the wages of sin is death. Romans 6:23 says this, the wages of sin is death. He planned it in a way, it is always the good heart of our Father looking towards that we will turn to him. Have you noticed when God, even when you were alone, when you were away, there's this unction in you, God is calling you back. Have you noticed that? God protects you from accidents. He will protect you. This, why? There's this emptiness that is in you. When you're alone, when there's no more the sound of the business of life, you begin to be alone. Says, God, is this it? Is this life? Because no amount of money, no amount of relationship, no amount of property can ever, 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 ever satisfy the soul of a man aside from God. Some of you know this. Some of you know somebody. No amount can ever. But until we go back to the loving hands of our Father. So sacrifice, and the sacrifice is temporary. Can you imagine in your old covenant, you have to continue the ritual of having to sacrifice? Sacrifice under the old covenant is temporary. That is a nutshell on the old covenant. Amen. Can you imagine that? Who wants to go back to the old covenant? None. Because it's so tedious. It's so hard. But then, hallelujah. Can someone say amen? In the perfect time, while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Come on now. Is somebody happy here? Are you happy? Just like the Gladiator, aren't you entertained? No, that's from the Gladiator movie, so you'll get it later. God is saying, look, I put all the penalty of sin, but I'm giving you the perfect lamb. John the Baptist says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. 4,000 years in darkness, and suddenly, at the perfect time, brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ walked into history. Why? Because the sacrifice in the old covenant is not enough. It is always short. It is always not enough. And that is how God planned it. Why? It is his earth. It is his, if you want, you don't believe that, goes to another planet. It is his world. He created it for you and me. Then comes the new covenant. And then he began to say in Matthew 26, repeated before he was betrayed, surrounded by his friends. No ideas. They don't have any ideas. Peter, the loud mouth, he was looked, mesmerized. The rest, they were leaning. As a matter of fact, if you think about it, they had a problem looking for a table. Jesus Christ says to Peter, Peter, go get the upper room and find a table good for all of us. Now, the table's got to be special. All of us should be looking out the window. Have you seen the Lord's Supper, Last Supper? Do you see anybody in the behind them? All of them are in a row, right? That's a joke, on the row. They were taking selfie, actually. Everyone. There was no one on one side. Everyone was looking. I said, hey, somebody's going to picture us one of these days, so let's be on one side. Did you see that? Have you seen that? There was no other on the front because all of them were looking. One of these days, there'll be a selfie by they know. And so Jesus Christ says, he broke the bread. He blessed it. He gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body. The initial one said, well, huh? What are you doing? They don't know. He took a cup. He blessed it, gave it to the disciples, and take, eat, a drink. This is the new covenant in my blood. The new covenant, they cannot really function. What is he talking about? And then Paul in 1 Corinthians 11 says, the same news that I received from the Lord, I give it to you. The church Corinth says, the night he was betrayed, it was repeated, repeated, repeated. And it sometimes has become tradition, but there is a segment of substance why we are supposed to partake of the Lord's table. It was an action by Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago that he has to what? To be the final Passover lamb to complete what God has initiated in history, because no amount of the death of an animal is sufficient for the forgiveness of our sin. And Jesus Christ took the brunt of the law. He was nailed to the cross. And when he says, "It is finished," it is finished, Jesus Christ says, "Now I am the perfect answer to what God has initiated, the perfect Lamb of God." But we have a choice, don't we? Either we receive what God has given to us, a substitute for each one of us. Either we do it on our own or receive the substitute that God has planned for redemption of our sins. See, some people say, well, you have to receive His grace plus. Work must be a result of God's grace. You can say, "I received Christ plus there's none anymore," because the new covenant is the covenant of grace. Unmerited favor. Unmerited, unearned. Anything that we do is not sufficient. His blood was shed at the cross to cover my sins. And God says, "It is finished." Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15 says, "The need for a second has to be there because it is the perfect lamb that must be slain." The new covenant is unconditional. Unconditional. Unconditional love. All we need is to receive what Jesus Christ has given to us. In any agreement, there has to be terms. Let us focus on the terms and condition of why the new covenant is far, far better than the old covenant. Let me tell you what are the terms and condition of the new covenant. Are you interested? You want to know? Number one is this. The first term is this. We are sinners and guilty before God. Term number one. We are sinners and guilty before God. Number two. We deserve punishment. The wage of sin is death. Number three term. Christ, our substitute, took our punishment. His blood was shed for us upon the cross. Third term. Fourth term. If we accept His sacrifice for us, His blood covers our sins. Number five, we're forgiven on the basis of Christ's sacrifice. Look at the term. I want you to know this term are all positive to our side. They're not to God's advantage. Whose advantage? It is for all of us. Number six. And then God will write the law in our hearts and enable us to live a holy life. Look at the term of the condition of God on our behalf. The terms are this, that we are sinners, that we are guilty of punishment, that Jesus Christ is a substitute. If we accept His forgiveness, then we can live by grace. Look at all the terms. Whose advantage? It is your advantage, my advantage. All we need to do, for by faith we receive and accept Jesus Christ when He was hanging on the cross. The other guy says, "Jesus, remember me when you are in paradise." If that was condition, would say, "You know what, man, you have to go down first, make good work." But what did this guy say? "Today, you are with me." Grace, belief. That the sufficiency of God's sacrifice in Jesus Christ is enough to pay back the penalty of our sin. For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God, what is it? Is eternal life through Jesus Christ. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. So when we come to the communion, no pastor, no leader or priest can ever listen to me very carefully. According to the word, there is no such thing as a term substantiation. No, I cannot lift up the cup and says, this is the blood of the new covenant. I cannot change it into the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. That is not true, because Jesus Christ, once and for all, can somebody say amen? Once and for all, he gave his life once and for all, not to be repeated and repeated according to the old covenant. Jesus Christ did it once and for all. And all we need to do is what? Believe that the sufficiency of what he had done is enough to forgive us of our sins. Am I yelling too much? Forgive me. But I'm just so excited to let you know that no amount of good works aside from grace can ever save us. No amount of going and you believe. If you watch the movie, that movie, The Last Crusade. That was in the 80s, I think, 70s. Have you watched that movie, The Last Crusade? Indiana Jones? That chalice for the movie, or for one, it's an archaeological importance. That chalice can never save us. The chalice is not what saves us. It is what is represented that contains. It is the blood of Jesus Christ that was done 2,000 years ago. And that is the reason why we celebrate. We celebrate according to what we have discussed here. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 says, number one is this. When we partake of the Lord's communion, it's the Lord's communion. It is not mine, it is not the church's, it is not yours. It is his communion. They are conditioned. Number one is this. It is an act of submission. It is an act of submission that we believe that what that represent that happened 2,000 years ago happened by faith, believing. Number two, it is a submission of remembering. It is submission. It is an act of remembering. As often as you do it, you remember. You remember. See, sometimes each one of us, we have a short memory of what had happened. Some of us even forget the birthdays of our loved ones. Some of us forget many things. But one thing that you and I should never forget is that 2,000 years ago, hallelujah, that Jesus Christ, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever, came. And he died for us. Never forget. When the enemy says you are too sinful, tell them, 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ paid the penalty for my sins. And that is more than enough. Number three is this. It's an act of proclamation. That's why when we confess Christ has died, Christ is risen. Christ is not coming back anymore. What does it say? Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ is coming back again. He completed the two, and the third one is coming up. That is the reason why we have an act of anticipation. It could be now, it could be tomorrow, it could be anytime, at the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, he will come, whether you like it or not, whether you believe it or not, but as we proclaim, he is coming back again. We better be ready for his coming. We better be ready, because Jesus Christ did not come to have given us a comfort life. Jesus Christ has come to pay the penalty of our sins, to get us ready for the kingdom of God. Amen. Because he has a kingdom for all of us. But in the meantime, as we remember what he had done, remember, doesn't matter how many times that you will take of the communion if you and I do not understand what it signifies. That's the reason why Paul warned them, those in an unworthy manner. It is not about who we are. We are all unworthy. Can someone say amen? Paul was saying, unworthy manner. What does it mean? If you and I do not understand what these emblems represent, if we take them and go back to our old life, then we are putting what Jesus Christ has done to nothing. What he's simply saying is this, if we take of this as an antidote or a patch, like a band-aid to feel us, make us feel good, that is not sufficient. There has to be a change in our heart. There has to be from kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. That is the reason why Paul says this. For many of you are sick. Many of you are already RIP. Because why? Because of what Jesus Christ has done. Please forgive me if I'm yelling too much. It's just I'm just a little bit excited because I got it from these guys. I'm a very mild-mannered person. Really, seriously, ask my wife. I'm very mild-mannered. But some of us need to know this. You are sometimes, brothers and sisters, I kid you not. Don't wait for the church to pray for you when you are dead because there's no more. God says it is appointed unto man for to die and then judgment. No amount of prayer when we are dead is sufficient to give us a little bit of somebody pray and then you begin to go up. No, it is now. The decision has to be made now. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation. Because Jesus Christ died for each one of us to have life eternal. Would you please bow your heads? Father, again, we thank you. Thank you, God, for the Lord's table. And forgive me, God, for if I yell too much. Forgive me. But I just cannot hold it in my heart, God. The cobwebs of our unbelief can take away our minds. Sometimes we can never understand, and we feel that if we don't understand with our mind and our heart, it's not got to be true. But, oh God, you are more than our thoughts and our mind. We can never explain the greatness of your love. By faith, it is impossible for us to please you unless we believe that you first are God. Lord, this morning as we come and partake of the Lord's communion, I ask you, Lord, that you prepare our hearts. That Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, walked this earth. The Rose of Sharon, the Lily of the Valley, the bright and morning star. At his command, the angels would bow down. And yet there was no second option for God to save mankind. So he sent his son to die. For the law demands payment. Sin demands payment. But there's no option to you in Jesus Christ. His obedience to the Father. For while we are yet sinners, Christ died. What an amazing love, Father. I ask you, Lord, that you will begin to restore, that you will begin to allow us to understand the greatness, the depth, the width, the height, unmeasurable love. May we continue to focus upon Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. Who are we, God, that you would even love us? Who are we? I ask you, Lord. While every heads are bowed and eyes are closed, perhaps you have been taking communion and you and I never understood. Maybe it's a tradition for us, but not understanding the gravity of what took place 2,000 years ago. Isaiah proclaimed that when you see him, you cannot even see his face. It was marred. It was bruised. For our iniquities was upon him, and by his stripes, his wounds, we are healed. Lord, I ask you, the terms are to our favor. We are sinners, guilty, separation from you, but you sent Jesus Christ. Because none can ever, ever, ever be good enough, to work good enough, to offer enough. You made it so, look so simple, and yet, wow. Forgive us. We confess we are sinners before you. We are guilty of separation from you. We confess our weaknesses before you, our sins before you. We miss the target many, 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 many times. Father God, today we declare, forgive us. We repent of our sins. Brothers, sisters, I don't know you, but if you're playing with fire, if you're playing with something that is not of God, the Holy Spirit loves you so much, but he will not look away from our sins. But there's a way out, and that is to repent, to turn away, and to live life. For one of these days, that judgment will come quick. But God is saying, today, if you hear salvation, if you hear the good news, do not harden your heart. Forgive us. We receive the sacrifice made possible by Jesus Christ. We thank you for the emblem of the bread. We thank you that your body was hung at the cross with all our sins. We thank you for the emblem of the wine, the fruit of the wine, symbolizing the blood that was shed, not of an animal, but finality, the blood of the Lamb, the perfect Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And as we partake this morning, God, I pray that you will cleanse us. Cleanse us from all our fear and failures. We may fail you, God, but you will never disown us, because Jesus Christ has suffered for us. We thank you, God, this morning. In Jesus' name, we pray. And everyone will say, amen and amen. I'd like to call the ushers, please, to come. Jesus. May I invite everyone please to stand. Lord, again, we thank you so much for your goodness. For dying for us. Jesus, we bless you. We take by faith, believing the sufficiency of your sacrifice and the penalty of sin paid in full. In Jesus' name. Let us all partake of the emblem of the bread representing the broken body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus, we thank you that 2,000 years ago you fulfilled the requirement for the payment of our sins. No amount of animal sacrifice has been sufficient but the perfect time. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, came. His blood was shed, for without the shedding of the blood, there is no forgiveness, payment of our sins. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. Let us all partake of the emblem of the fruit of the vine representing the shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Would you kindly just lift up your hands before heaven and make a confession before him from coming from a grateful heart. Thank you so much. Father, we thank you. I thank you for the plan of the ages. Jesus, I thank you for your obedience, even unto death, for the freedom that was made possible. The sacrifice was made. So thank you, God, for adopting us into your kingdom through Jesus Christ. Jesus, help us by the power of the Holy Spirit to live a life worthy as we anticipate your return. May we live a life worthy to be called your sons and daughters. We give you all the honor and glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, and everyone will say, amen, amen. Can we give God the glory, please? Amen. You may be seated. Thank you so much. God bless you.
So give a round of applause to the word this morning. Understanding, amen, the Lord's Supper. That Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God, the once and for all sacrifice. And for all that is done for us in the cross of Calvary. Amen. So as we partake of the communion, we always remember that he offered his life for us and the promise of eternal life in him.